Here at Maynooth University, we really are trying to play our part to tackle the problem of climate change. Now, Maynooth University is Ireland's leading institution for climate change research and for teaching. And our researchers are internationally recognised. They are bringing their strengths across areas such as climate modelling, scrutinising severe weather events for mitigation, right through to examining the social and economic impacts of climate change, for example, moving away from carbon.
When we talk about climate change, we typically refer to changes in the mean or average conditions. So for example, we talk about wetter winters, drier summers, seasonal changes in temperature. However, it's changes in the extremes that are likely to have a much more disproportionate effect. And we've seen this throughout Europe and elsewhere, certainly over the past two decades, with intensification of precipitation and associated flooding, or also the occurrence of both heat and drought waves, particularly throughout Europe, evident in the last number of years. While we can analyse or diagnose some of the effects using the available instrumental records, these are very useful in allowing us to detect past changes in the climate system. However, if we were to inform or develop much more effective strategies around managing our environment, we really need to more fully understand the processes that give rise to weather and ultimately the climate we experience at a particular location. So my research is primarily focused on understanding the interactions between the atmosphere and the underlying land surface and how they interact or exchange, communicate information. We can think of these interactions in terms of the exchanges of heat between the air or the surface and the air, in terms of moisture, precipitation or evaporation, but also in terms of momentum or winds, how they transfer or export heat, moisture or pollutants into a particular location.
So one key challenge we have, I guess, is trying to figure out what's going on in terms of land cover on the surface of the earth. And not just that, but also the activity associated with that, how that land cover is managed. So it could be something like grasslands and whether that's intensely grazed or not. So my work then deals with, the measurement, the reporting and verification of that sort of activity. So I look at the observation systems and the computation systems. Observation, looking from spaceborne right through to airborne and terrestrial-based platforms, sensors, looking at an array of sensors, looking at multispectral, hyperspectral navigation, LIDAR and radar systems, and on the computational side then trying to fuse these data sets.
Some of the big concerns we have around climate change is how rainfall will change in the future, whether we get more in winter, less in summer, and what that means for water resources and floods. So my research is all about trying to understand how climate change impacts on rainfall and therefore on hydrology. And I'm interested in the future in terms of what we can learn from climate models. And I'm particularly interested in the past, looking back through historical records to understand the nature of extreme events historically and what they can tell us about building resilience now and into the future.
Climate is changing, and while many people would understand that rising global temperatures are a well-known impact of climate change, there are many other impacts. For example, I am very interested in the changing ocean circulation. So the Gulf Stream system of currents that Ireland relies on for its supply of heat is predicted to weaken substantially in the coming years.
My research can address the challenges of climate change because we don't know very much about past weather variability because instrumental records are fairly short. That means that by looking at long records of past storminess, we can understand more about the changing frequency and occurrence of storms in the past. And that will also help us understand future climate changes as well. Another important aspect of looking at past climate is that we can look at previous warm periods and see whether storminess increased or decreased during those times.
A really critical part of climate change is that of changes in the extremes of temperature, of wind, of rainfall. And my research group are taking data created by Meteran and looking at how climate extremes are increasing over the past 30 years. We took a period of time where we had measurements, 30 years from 1981 to 2010, and we looked at how many extremely warm days there were during that period, and then we compared it with newer data from the last decade. And remarkably, extreme temperatures in certain places have gone up by up to 20%, a massive increase. And we really need to work out whether that's occurring all over the island of Ireland.
When we think about the burdens of climate change, we often think about people who are exposed to flooding or to storm events. But it's also important that we think about those sectors of the population or those areas that will be hardest hit by climate policies. So if we think about the transition towards a low carbon future, we think about particularly those workers who maybe work in carbon intensive sectors. So in Ireland, a key example of that is the Midlands, where over the next few years and decade, the peat industry is going to be closed down, resulting in the loss of jobs for between 3,000 and 4,000 people. So when we think about climate change and climate change policy, we have to be thinking about a just transition. So what are the kinds of jobs, what are the kinds of livelihoods, what are the kinds of regional development, landscape restoration that can be put in place to look after those places and to look after those workers in those communities?
Our research is trying to commercialize a new modality of renewable energy that currently doesn't appear on the grid. We're familiar with wind energy, but when the wind doesn't blow, we need some other renewable energy source to counterbalance that.
So the air goes up and down, it always goes the same way.
The problem at the moment is that wave energy is a little bit too expensive, so we're trying to optimize that technology to bring the cost down and therefore to make it competitive both with other renewable energy sources and also with other conventional energy sources. These days, the increased electrification of transport, that electricity has to come from somewhere and it has to come from a carbon-free source. Thankfully, Ireland has a fantastic wave climate. It has actually got enough energy to satisfy all of Ireland's electrical needs at the moment, if we tapped it all and we had the technology to do it.
Well, when we think about the low carbon transition, so the move towards a low carbon future, we have to think about how that can be fair and just. And there are at least two reasons for that. The first is, if policies are reinforcing existing inequalities, they won't be popular and they'll be resisted. And the second, and perhaps more important reason, is that we can see this moment as an opportunity. So the move towards a low carbon future can be an opportunity to democratize energy systems. It can be a moment to rejuvenate rural economies, rural livelihoods, and to invest in low carbon jobs, such as in green infrastructure or childcare.
We hope that if we can quantify sea level rise in different locations around the country, that will help people in lots of different ways. It will help in terms of the building of sea level walls, so that it will insure us against future disasters. It might help in terms of flooding, as rivers tend to flow into the sea, and we can work out where flood defences need to be improved. And it can also help in things like planning. If you're building housing estates on floodplains, we need to know what the likely risks are there, and we hope to be able to identify those particular problems and help people when we're choosing the next generation of how we live.
I hope that my research will help to inform coastal communities and decision makers in those areas about the potential for changes in storminess in the future.
The practical output of our research is in partnership with our industry partners. Most of our research is quite fundamental, so it focuses on theory, on numerical studies, and also on small-scale experimentation.
My research and the insights it's developing about the past and future are crucial to building a more resilient Ireland. Our society, our economy, our environment depends on adequate supply of water resources, but also in terms of defence from extremes. So I'm eager that my research underpins decision making about infrastructure in the water sector, about defending from flood events, and by developing adaptation plans at local and national level.
So our research is directed towards monitoring, reporting and verification in terms of what's going on down on the land surface. And it's not alone dealing with the land cover itself, but the actual activity associated with that land cover. So these geoinformation services can be used by farmers to develop low carbon, more sustainable farming practices, and also by government to formulate policy at a national level and indeed feed into European policy formulation.
The main thing that I would hope from my research is that there's a growing appreciation of the importance of the marine environment for Ireland's climate. We're a small island on the edge of a large ocean, and that ocean is changing very rapidly. So we know that understanding better the changing currents, the changing circulation, and the impacts that that might have on storminess and on sea level rise can really help us to understand how the climate in Ireland is going to change going forward and adapt accordingly.
Part of my research, I'm very interested in trying to understand what the future implications of climate change might be. In order to answer some of these questions, we run a numerical climate model, and this enables us to investigate how future temperatures are likely to change as a consequence of changing emissions, how future precipitation patterns may alter as a consequence of future emissions. This research is central to informing national, regional, and local policies with regards to developing appropriate adaptation and mitigation options that we can increase our resilience to the future changes in the climate system or reduce the severity of the associated impacts.
A key part of a just transition is the inclusion of communities, particularly communities that are going to be most affected by climate change or by climate policies. In my research, I work with communities both to create a space in which their concerns can be voiced and raised, but also as a means to incorporate their expertise, their judgments, their values in the policy-making process and in planning for the future.
The major impact of COVID-19 has actually been to completely understandably shove climate way down the priority list for people. COVID-19 is a here and now problem. But what we've got to remember is that COVID-19 is like tsunami after an earthquake. COVID-19 is the first relatively small wave. Climate change is the second much larger wave. So while we must concentrate in the short term about COVID-19 and COVID-19 impacts, if we take our eye off the ball of climate change, we're going to make matters far worse. And in a way, if you ask the epidemiologists, the emergence of COVID-19 and other potential pandemics is very much related to the stress we're placing on the Earth's system, climate change, but also biodiversity, encroachment into natural habitats. All of these are bringing pathogens in closer, more frequent contact with humans, and it's only a matter of time before those pathogens move across to humanity. Ireland has a huge potential, Maynooth has a huge potential to really engage in the general problems around COVID-19, around climate change, around the solution space. We're a relatively small country, and lots of people use that as an excuse to we can't make a meaningful difference at the global scale. Well, everything that's ever happened is because somebody has innovated. It takes one person with one great idea to move the world, fundamentally. So there's no reason why we cannot be the people who have that idea. If we have that idea, if we become the leader in addressing the emergencies of climate, of biodiversity, the risks that those entail for human health, then we have a huge opportunity to take global leadership positions with all of the economic and societal benefits that accrue from doing so. So there's a huge opportunity. We should embrace that opportunity and run with it.